Hello and welcome to the show. My name is Apingo, and I am that Chinese history guy. On the show, we share the stories from the myths, legends, and histories of the Chinese people, from the first creator to the last imperial dynasty. More than 6,000 years of stories, one video at a time. And if you like content like this, remember to like, sub, comment, and share this video and this channel with your friends. Now, in this episode of the Shang Dynasty, we are going to talk about how the growth of a very common weed that we kind of see very often nowadays brought about a mini revival in the fortunes of the Shang rule, and how the lack of a codified law of succession caused 116 years of chaos and almost destroyed the Shang dynasty from within. Now, after King Kaijia, whom we spoke about in the previous episode, after he passed away, the Shang dynasty went through four kings in King Wuding, Taigeng, Xiaojia, and Yongsi. Now, during the reigns of these four kings, nothing much was accomplished. In fact, one could say that these four rulers basically just went through the motion of occupying the throne. And so, you know, the Shang dynasty went through a period of downturn, you could say. Vassal states and external tribes started drifting away from Shang influence, and the public infrastructure started to fall into disrepair. And the Shang dynasty, you know, kind of seemed barely holding itself together. It seemed like it was barely holding itself together. Now, it was at this time that King Tai Wu ascended to the throne. Now, Tai Wu ascended to the throne as a youth, most probably a teenager or early teens, you know. And like all teenagers, you know, he don't really care for work. He did not care much for the affairs of state. And like most teenagers, he was only interested in enjoying the wealth and the privilege that his position and his office brought him. And of course, the various forms of indulgences that his imaginative teenage mind could conjure up. I mean, if you have a teenager in a home, you would know, and come on, we've all been teenagers before. We know what it's like. So yeah, imagine that as a king. Now, at this time, there grew this majestic mulberry tree in the palace courtyard. And of course, we know mulberry trees are very useful plants, especially in those times. The leaves could be used to rear these silkworms, which in turn produce silk. And of course, the tree itself, the trunk, the wood, the timber, and the bark were very useful. So there was this majestic mulberry tree growing in the palace courtyard at that time. And in the 7th year of King Tai Wu's reign, a papal mulberry plant sprouted at the base of this old mulberry tree. Now, we know mulberry trees, but what is a papal mulberry plant? It is kind of a parasitic weed, a plant which grows very fast and is very invasive. And even today, this paper mulberry is a big problem in many parts of the world where they, you know, got in and they started propagating at alarming rates and kind of like crowd out and killed off the local plants of the area. So it is quite a big problem even today. So yeah, back to the story. In the 7th year of his reign, this small paper mulberry plant sprouted somehow at the base of this big majestic mulberry tree in the middle of the palace courtyard. And you know, it grew at an alarming rate, like any parasitic weed would. And within 7 days, it grew to such a size that it threatened to crowd out the original tree and to, you know, suffocate it, to kill it. And of course, we are talking about like what, 1700-1800 BC. So due to a lack of natural botanical knowledge at that time, rumors started to fly all over the place. You know, it began to spread that, you know, oh my god, you know, this is a bad omen. This is the work of demons, you know, forces of evil at work. And of course, you know, King Tai Wu, being the king on the throne, started to get worried about all these rumors and this talk of the work of the demon, of a bad omen. And You know, of course, he was anxious and he was worried that it was a sign of impending catastrophe for him, his position, and his people. Now, at this time in the Shang court, Yi In's son, Yi Zhi, was the counselor or at least a high-ranking official in the Shang court. And he made use of this opportunity, you know, when the king was anxious, he made use of this opportunity to advise the worried king, the anxious king, that, you know, my lord, my king, you do know that, you know, no work of the demons or no evil omens can overcome the virtues of a wise and diligent king, right? Now, if let's say the king of the realm could reflect on his own actions and correct any behaviors that might have been, you know, in contradiction to the teachings of the sages, you know, things like not caring about work, things like being slack in ruling the nation, things like, you know, just thinking about enjoyment, things like that. If the king could correct these kind of behaviors, and if the king of the realm could rule, you know, with the people's benefits as his guiding principle, as his core principle in governance, any evil omens or any evil influences would disappear on their own. Now, at this time, with all the rumors flying, and, you know, you can see with your own eyes that this sudden plant that suddenly sprouted out of nowhere was like really crowding out the big mulberry tree at on palace grounds, no less. I mean, with all these things happening, of course, King Tai Wu was, you know, kind of worried, and he was like, yeah, maybe, you know, my dear Yi Zhi had a point. Maybe, you know, what he says makes sense. Yeah, I mean, what's the worst that could happen if I change my ways? So, you know, King Tai Wu really took Yi Zhi's words to heart, and he indeed, you know, did his best to change his ways. He began dedicating more of his efforts into ruling the land, as any diligent king would, and he took a more proactive approach in spreading the ideals of virtues, you know, among his people. Now, the paper mulberry plant, although it's a very common weed today, and while it's highly invasive and it grows at alarming rate very fast, like any weeds or any parasitic plants would, it is a deciduous plant that dies off naturally when it reaches a certain state of growth. If it did not propagate on its own, it will die off after a certain period of time. Now, but when this particular specimen that was on palace grounds, when this particular specimen died naturally, as with all paper mulberry would do, King Tai Wu naturally assumed that it was his newfound diligence and virtues that overcame the forces of evil at work, and thus it was his diligence and his virtues that killed off this devil spawn, you know. And of course, this spurred King Tai Wu on to redouble his efforts in becoming a better king to his people and to spend more time in ensuring that his land is well governed, and, you know, dedicating effort to making the lives of his people, his subjects, better. Now, King Tai Wu was the longest reigning king of the Shang dynasty on record. It is said that he was on the throne for 75 years. And during his reign, the influence of the Shang court kind of enjoyed a brief period of resurgence. Vassal states resumed sending tribute to the central court, and they re-swore their allegiance to the Shang royal line. And the realm, the people, enjoyed a period of growth and prosperity, and the people's standard of living improved markedly over the reigns of the previous few kings. Now, due to his contributions in bringing about this small resurgence, or this small revival in the fate of the Shang dynasty, King Tai Wu was known and recognized by later Shang kings as the middle ancestor, or Zhongzhong, of the Shang people. Now, however, despite King Tai Wu's best efforts, the peace and prosperity of the realm did not last beyond his own time on the throne. In fact, his passing after 75 years on the throne, after 75 years of peace and prosperity, after his passing, it basically ushered in what is known as the Chaos of Nine Kings or 九世之乱, where almost every succession or every transfer of power was accomplished through bloody coups or palace intrigue. Okay, to kind of explain what went wrong after Tai Wu's passing, we have to go back a few generations, right to the beginning of the foundation of the Shang Dynasty. So what happened was that when Shang Tang founded the Shang Dynasty, the law of succession was not laid down officially. Thus, the succession of to the Shang throne was based more on tradition than on any official law of the land. Now, the early Shang Dynasty followed what is now known as a Rota system, R-O-T-A, Rota system, where the throne is passed not linearly from father to son, instead it's passed on laterally from brother to brother. So, you know, the oldest brother will hold the throne and then you pass on to the next oldest in line and then the next oldest and next oldest until the entire generation of brothers, of siblings were all died out. And then the throne will be passed to the eldest son of the eldest brother who held the throne before. So yeah, confused yet? Yeah, it is kind of confusing. So, but bear with me. Now the system served its purpose without much trouble in the early days. However, things changed when Shang Dynasty's ninth king, Tai Wu, passed away. Okay, the next part of this video, this story, is gonna be a bit confusing, so I'm gonna put up this chart on the screen now, and so you can, you know, kind of like figure out the relationship between all these kings and all these rulers. I mean, it took me quite a while to figure out all this succession and this relationship, so yeah, it would help if you can whack the like button for this video. Thank you very much. Okay, back to the story. Now, if you look on the chart, Tai Wu was a ninth king, and after he passed away, his son, King Zhongting, ascended to the throne through a bloody and intense palace coup, which basically ousted his uncles from the line of succession, and he seized the throne for himself. Now, in order to avoid the reprisal and revenge and vengeance from his uncles and their supporters, Zhongting moved the capital to this place called Xiao, which is northeast of today's Henan Xingyang. Now, during King Zhongting's reign, the Dongyi tribes to the east launched various invasion campaigns into Shang lands. I mean, they took the opportunity of this chaos within the Shang kingdom to launch these invasions. And in the sixth year of Zhongting's reign, the Lan Yi branch of the invaders were successfully defeated and repelled from the lands of the Shang. However, it was also the start of a decades-long conflict between the Shang dynasty, the Shang lands, the Shang people, and the Dongyi people to the east and the southeast. Now, Zhongting was on the throne for 11 years before passing on from illness, and he was succeeded by his brother, King Wai Ren, who ascended through another coup. However, apart from the coup, Wai Ren made some compromises and, you know, gave up some of his powers, you know, to his other brothers. And due to his compromises and the fracturing of the power in his hands, he spent 15 rather ineffective years on the throne. Because he did not hold all the power in his hands, there wasn't much that he could do apart from sitting on the throne. So yeah, a lot of things he wants to, maybe some policies he want to roll out or some things he want change. He couldn't execute on those orders, he couldn't deliver those decrees because there would be other factions that would be opposed to his ideas. So yeah, 15 years on the throne, not much contributions apart from the fact that it was another period of decline in power for the Shang dynasty, and he passed away from illness. And King Wai Ren was succeeded by his brother after 15 years on the throne. he was succeeded by his brother He Danjia, who once again moved the capital to this place called Xiang, which is in today's Henan Neihuang region. Of course, again, to avoid the threats that were posed by his siblings and their supporters. Now, why do they keep moving the capitals whenever someone new come onto the throne? Now, it serves a few purposes. Number one, the nobles, the power base of the previous occupant of the throne are all entrenched and rooted in the capital. So when a new ruler came to the throne through not so proper means, i.e. palace coup, palace intrigue, they moved the capital, number one, to put a distance between themselves and the other factions, the other claimants to the thrones. And number two, by moving the capital to a new place, they could raise a new group of nobles that were loyal to them, who were their supporters, and thereby building their own power base, you know, in the process. However, this also created a very big problem. Why do I say that? Because it takes time to build up an economy in any place, in any city. And what happens was that when you build a new capital, you are migrating a huge number of people and resources into a new place, and of course there will be some that are left behind, and you have to rebuild the entire economy from scratch in the new capital. And so all this moving actually takes a very big toll on the economy and on society, although it gives the new ruler a certain sense of a certain sense of safety from the other threats, from the political threats. Yeah, so that's why we will see a lot of capitals moving here and there over the next few successions, over the next few transfer of power. Now, back to the story. So He Danjia succeeded his brother and he moved the capital to this place called Xiang, which is today's Henan Neihuang area, of course, to avoid the threats posed by his siblings and their supporters. And he was on the throne for 9 years. And in the 9 years that He Danjia was on the throne, he managed to invade and put down the Lan Yi and the Panfang branches of the Tong Yi people with the help of some vassal lords who were still loyal to the Shang court. However, although He Danjia's 9 years on the throne was kind of a show of force to, you know, the minor lords and the external tribes and clans, military-wise, it was a show of force. The economy of the Shang government, the Shang rule, was pushed even further into the doldrums due to the massive expenses, you know, incurred when you launch military campaigns, when you move your capital so much. So who pays in the end? The people pay, the society paid. So when He Danjia, when King He Danjia passed on due to illness, his son Zhu Yi once again staged a bloody coup to seize the throne. And, you know, once again, King Zhu Yi attempted to move the capital to escape from the threats of the other claimants to the throne. However, this was quite an interesting story. His first attempt to move the capital was to this hastily chosen location called Xing, which is in today's Henan Wen region. It was a disaster because I believe they were so hasty in choosing this new location for the capital that they did not conduct a very thorough or very proper land survey to, you know, gauge the suitability of the area. So just after the foundations were laid and before construction was even completed, the entire region was flooded by the Yellow River. So yeah, that plan was moot. And they had to choose a new location, which is at this place called P, which is in today's Shandong Yutai area. And they finally moved the capital over there. Now, due to the abundance of fresh water sources and fertile farming lands in this new capital at P, Shang economy actually enjoyed a brief period of revival under Zhu Yi's 19-year reign. Now, during this time, King Zhu Yi also launched numerous invasion campaigns, which went further and deeper into Dongyi lands, and he, in effect, put an end to the decades-long conflict between the Shang people and the Dongyi people. Now, it was also said that it was during Zhu Yi's reign that the solar calendar, the Chinese version of the solar calendar, was discovered by one of his subjects named Wan Nian. And in commemoration of this discovery, the Chinese version of the solar calendar is also known as the Wan Nian calendar or Wan Nian Li. Now, after 19 years on the throne, King Zhu Yi passed away from illness and he was succeeded by his son, Zhu Xin. King Zhu Xin ruled 16 years on the throne before passing away from illness. Now, after Zhu Xin passed away, he was succeeded by his brother, King Wu Jia, who ruled for 5 years before dying from illness himself. And now, the throne then passed back to Zhu Yi's son, named Zhu Ting, who ruled for 9 years before dying. And then Zhu Ting was then succeeded by his cousin, who was King Zhu Xin's son, named Nan Geng. Now, King Nan Geng ruled for 25 years before passing on from illness as well. And during King Nan Geng's reign, the capital was moved to this place called An, which is in today's Shandong Qifu region. However, by the end of King Nan Geng's reign, the Shang dynasty had suffered through, you know, years and years and generations of steady decline because of all the capital moving and all the economical consequences that I spoke about earlier, and all these military campaigns. And so, you know, and of course all the power grabs and all the palace intrigues and the political instability and all that jazz and all those things that were going on. So, you know, by the time of King Nan Geng's reign, the Shang dynasty was basically barely even a pale shadow of its former self. It was broke, it was weak, and basically nobody outside of the central court really gave a damn about them. Yeah. So after King Nan Geng passed away, after his 25 years on the throne, the throne passed back to King Zhu Ting's son named Yang Jia. Now, King Yang Jia also seized the throne through another palace coup and ruled for the next 7 years. However, to be very honest, I have no idea why anyone would want to be a king of the Shang dynasty by this time, because the Shang court was already in total disarray and King Yang Jia practically had no control over the realm. Vassal lords, I mean, if you could still call them that, were just vassal lords in name. They totally ignored any order or decree from the king. Instead, they would spend their time, you know, attacking each other and invading each other's fiefdoms to grow their own power bases. And, you know, they just acknowledge or recognize the king of the Shang dynasty in name. It's like, oh yeah, you're the king. Yeah, good for you, man. Now we are going to do our own thing. Yeah, something like that. And, you know, external forces or the external threats from outside of the Shang kingdom were, they were basically just waiting for the Shang kingdom to implode and destroy itself from within. And to be very honest, it was a very real threat that would indeed be the case. So let's do a short recap. Since the passing of King Tai Wu, there has been 9 successive kings who all came to the throne through coups and intrigue. And that resulted in 116 years of political turmoil and instability. And by this time, the Shang dynasty has almost destroyed itself from within. The economy was practically non-existent. It was nerfed, you know, due to the frequent movement, the frequent moving of the capital, and the frequent changes in the ruling class and the nobility. And society was fractured by the different factions, political factions, and the different power bases that existed in the land. And of course, rebellions and invasions and, you know, conflict, internal conflict, was so frequent that it greatly taxed the coffers of the Shang court, you know, just to keep things together, just to keep things in one piece. Massive amount of money was being spent, and we all know they don't really have much income to begin with by this time. So from Shang Tang, the founder of the Shang dynasty, to King Yang Jia, the Shang dynasty had gone through 18 kings, and it was a real threat that by this time it would be the end of the line under Yang Jia's hand. But as luck would have it, the next ruler to ascend to the throne would pull the Shang dynasty back from the brink of implosion, back from the brink of annihilation, and bring about the next golden age of the Shang dynasty. Now, who is this fella who can, you know, basically create a miracle, and how did he do that? Well, I guess you have to watch the next episode to find out, won't you? Now, yeah, I understand that this has been quite a long break since the last video. Yeah, I took a longer break than usual due to reasons. Anyways, as usual, I hope you enjoyed the story as much as I enjoyed telling it. And if you did, remember, you know, like, sub, comment, share, do whatever you need. It helps the algorithm, it helps the channel. And if you would like to support the channel in a more tangible way, you could do so on Patreon. The links are available in the in the description box below, and that will greatly help keep the lights on around here. So thank you very much, and yeah, I guess that's it for today, and I will see you in the next episode.